Okay, so thanks for coming. I'm going to start right now. So how many of you actually, what's your level of Photoshop usage? I mean, like never used before, never touched before, never even double clicked the icon before. How many?
Lightroom.
Okay. So for you, have you used it before? No. Okay. Okay, so let me just... So Photoshop is one of the, is a very, very old software. Maybe some of you do not know. Okay, so this is a bit of history of it. It was first used in Industrial Light & Magic, the image processing software. It was created by these two brothers, John Noe and his brother Thomas, as a summer project. And it was used on this film. How many of you have heard of Industrial Light & Magic, or ILM for short? Never heard of it. It's the most famous visual effect company in the world. Okay, it's actually created, ILM is actually the, Industrial Light & Magic was actually created by George Lucas. And it was the company he created to do the special effect for the first Star Wars movie in 1970 something. So it is the company that does all the most groundbreaking visual effects. In fact, visual effects that, you know, totally new to the industry, like for example, Avatar was also, they were the people behind it. And John Noe is still working there today, and he's still the creative visual effect director of most of the most famous special effect films that you see today. So this was actually made, they actually created Photoshop and they sold it over to Adobe. Right, back in I think 1988 or something like that. Okay, actually Adobe, a lot of their software, most of their most famous software are not actually written by them. So Photoshop, they actually bought it. InDesign, it actually was actually Adobe, Elder's PageMaker, used to have Macromedia Flash, became Adobe Flash. Right. Okay, so in order to understand Photoshop, the first thing you have to understand is vector versus raster. How many of you have ever heard these two terms before? How many have heard it? No, never heard it before. Okay, so I'm going to explain to you. Okay, so let's consider this very simple shape. Okay, so this is, okay, sorry, it's not a white rectangle. It is a rectangle. Okay, and it's from light green to dark green. Right, how do you tell, how do you define this to a computer? What would be the, how many ways can you define it? What would be the easiest way to define this to a computer? I mean, because to a computer, he doesn't know, you need to give it some sort of data, right? That this is a rectangle, okay? So the easiest way to actually define this is very simple. So a vector implementation like this, a computer only need to know there are 4 points of a rectangle, and then after that, it will join the dots itself. Right, so you in truth, you only need 4 points to really know a rectangle, right? And then you just need to tell the computer from light green to dark green. Okay. So this is how a vector implementation actually works with that. It's very, very little data. Okay, and then a raster implementation is like this. I break the entire rectangle into many, many, many small squares. Every square is one shade of green. Okay, this is what we call a raster. Okay, and so what is the difference? Okay, I can do this in the vector, no problem. But when I want a photo, obviously I cannot define four corners and a color inside. Okay, a raster image like this is made up of every single dot here is a different color. Right? So that is what a raster image is. And you go down, there's two very main software from Adobe. One is Adobe Illustrator and one is Adobe Photoshop. So Adobe Photoshop is a raster processing software, whereas Adobe Illustrator is a vector processing software. Okay, I don't want to go too much on what is the vector side, so, but just recall it that. Photoshop is a raster software. Okay, so let's dive into a raster. Okay, so if you have, how many have seen this term DPI or PPI before? All right. Okay, so is actually dots per inch or pixels per inch. It is basically how many dots or pixels are there in 1 inch. Okay, so for print, usually we put it at 300, and for screen, we usually put it at 72. So let me just do a very quick jump over to Photoshop now. Okay, so if you have this, it doesn't matter, any one of these images, right? You can drag it into Photoshop and open it. Okay, so I open it in Photoshop, and what I want to show you is here, image and image size. Okay, we come here to image size. Okay, you see here that this, you can pan this around to somewhere like here. Okay, and then you see that this resolution, right? So resolution is 72 pixels per inch. Okay, let's change this to inches. Right, so you see the dimensions at the top here, 5312 pixels by 2988 pixels. Okay, so if I do a very simple calculation, right, 5312 divided by 73.7, that's how you get 73.7 inches here. You see that? So this is the number of pixels across, and my resolution is 72 pixels to 1 inch, therefore I have 73 inches. Okay? So this is good enough for screen, right? But when we want to do for print, what we do is that in 1 inch we have to shrink it much smaller. We have to put a lot more pixels in 1 inch when we want to print it. So right now if I were to change it like what I say 300, right? Whatever you see that now it becomes only 17 inches because we put a lot more pixels. Okay. Now so what we have done here is that we have actually just changed the resolution of the image only, but we did not change the actual dimension of the image. We did not change this value here, right? Now, if we were to click this resample, okay, let me change that to 72. Okay. Now, if I were to click here resample, this button here, what it does is that it will, if I were to change this now to 300, you see what happened? Now this whole image becomes bigger, but it's blurry. Okay, why does this happen? It's because you can see what we have here now is 22,000 over pixels. Right, just now when we were at 72, it was 5,000. So what Photoshop has done here is that it has actually tried to add pixels in to make it bigger. So you are actually adding pixels in, and when you add pixels in that was not originally there, this is what happens, the image becomes blur. And this is the reason why if you start from a low resolution image, you cannot like enlarge into super big. Okay? And that's why when you want to take a picture, you should always take the highest resolution. Because when you're from big, you want to become small, you don't have a problem. When small, you become big, it cannot be done. So all those shows about CSI where they show the window reflection, can see the other person how far away, and can see the number plate, it's all bullshit. There's no such thing. Okay, so that is go back to my CEO. Okay, so this is DPI and DPI. So for print, usually we put 300, which we try to shrink it more in, and for screen, usually 72 DPI. That's the general rule. So, now let's talk about keyboard shortcuts. Okay. So the reason why I give this talk is because I use Photoshop since, the first time I used Photoshop was in 1993, I think, or 94, very long time ago. And Photoshop is one of these software whereby you cannot just turn on and then you just try and guess how to use. It's not really possible to do it that way because there are certain concepts you must know how to use the software properly, and that this is why I wanted to have this talk. I wanted you guys to know the things which I wish I knew when I first double clicked on this program. But back in 1993, you don't really have that kind of, you don't have YouTube, right? That's the problem, and you don't go for books and all that. You can self-teach yourself the software, but it's a bit, it's quite tedious, but remember that you cannot just blindly just click and see what happens and hope to understand. You need to know the theory of why something happens in Photoshop. Okay, so the first thing I'd like to bring to your attention is that keyboard shortcuts. Okay, Adobe made actually all of their softwares for use with pointing device. It can be a mouse or tablet and with the keyboard together. So when you use Photoshop or any other Adobe software, one hand should always be on your keyboard. The left hand you're on the keyboard and the right hand on the mouse, or vice versa. Like you actually nobody use the mouse on the left hand. But yeah, so the most important three keys are always Control, Shift and Alternate, or Command, Shift and Alternate on the Mac. Okay, Control, Shift and Alternate on the PC, and Command, Shift and Alternate on the Mac. Okay, whenever you do something, whenever you drag something, if you hold Shift, it might constrain to something. If you hold Alternate, it will constrain to another thing. Okay, let me just give you a very quick example. Okay, so let's just... So now, if I were to go and... resize this rectangle now, okay, I'm not holding anything in my hand, right? It's going all over the place. Now, if you hold Shift, what happens is that you see it's proportional. It won't go out of shape, right? If you hold Shift and Alternate, both sides go together. Okay, so there's always something that you can do with Shift and Alternate. Okay, it's the same when you do if you were to draw a, like now I have this selection tool, I want to draw a rectangle, the same thing. If I hold Shift, it will actually constrain. If I hold Alternate, it will jump to, it will go from the center outwards. So if I hold like this, you see it will go outwards both ways. You guys can just click onto the selection tool and you can just try this. The space bar is also a very common tool. You can hold Shift, drag, Alternate, drag together. You can hold, after that you press space bar, you can actually move this. So you can use three different keyboard shortcuts together. Okay. So there's always a Shift and something that works. So the same with a zoom tool. Okay, let's say we do to the zoom tool, we want to drag in, we zoom in, right? Now, you see now I'm zooming in plus, right? Normally if you go come here and you will click minus to go out. But you actually hold the Alternate tool, it's actually zoom out. You see I just press the Alternate key, it changes. Yeah. So there's always something that's Alternate, Shift, Command, and spacebar will always be moving something. So if you're zooming here, you have to move around, you press spacebar, it will be panning and moving it around. Okay, that's the next one. So now, selection. Okay, so in Photoshop, okay, when you select something, so selection tools are all these over here. It can be a rectangle tool, right? It can be if you hold and select, it can be a elliptical marquee tool. That means it's the same thing, but it's circular. So the same thing, if you hold Shift, it will be a perfect circle. Okay, that's the selection. It can be a freehand tool.
The left side, right?
The
left
side.
Move your.
Oh. This is there. Let me see. Can't see. Okay. Okay, so if you click on the right here, you click and hold, you can select between the rectangular marquee tool or get hold, it can be the elliptical marquee tool. Okay. You have also here, this is the lasso tool, which is means that you draw freehand over the area you want. Or you can be the polygonal lasso tool, this is pretty much the same, but instead of drawing freehand, is that you click, and then you click again, you click again, 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 okay, to form a selection. Okay. If you guys need to ask me a question, just stop me, because there isn't really that many of you, can just stop me. Okay. And then there is over here, there is the Magic Wand tool, which is a very famous tool, and it's been in Photoshop since probably the first few hours. It's been there since I first used it. And what it does is it selects based on the color. So if you click on like this blue sky, you will select this blue sky. This. Okay. And there's also the Quick Selection tool, which is a new version of it, which you can just drag like that, and you'll keep selecting based on where you actually continue. Okay, so people who have used Photoshop for a long time actually do not like this tool. But yeah, you can try it. It's a new tool. It's actually not that new. It's been around since probably 4 or 5 versions back. Photoshop has now been up to 20 over versions already. And so yeah, with the, like I say, when you have the keyboard shortcut, right? Okay, so what you can do is that if you press on the, let me just go back to the rectangular marquee tool. So if, now you see I select here, then if I select again, it takes the new rectangle. Okay, so the same thing is keyboard shortcuts. You hold shift, you see the cursor changes. Okay, you see, comes a small little plus there. This means I can add to my selection. Okay, you press alternate, it becomes a minus, means I can minus away from my selection. So I say always try shift, alternate, it always does something. Okay, so that's the selection. So when you select anything, right, and then if I were to do any action on it, it will only affect the selection. This is very important. So that's how you target certain areas. For example, very simple, if let's say I were to go edit and I just go fill. Okay, and I fill with white color, I feel okay. It will only fill this rectangle. Right? Now if I go back, if I did not put a selection and I were to do the same thing, I did edit, fill, and then I put white, it fills the whole thing. Okay. And similarly, and anything you do, so even if you, let's say you do image adjustment, and I say I want to do hue saturation adjustment, right, and then I can move this, move right, anything you see that is happening happens only inside the selection and not outside the selection. Okay, so selections is important, and you must be wary of what you have selected. So quite often, right, is that when you select something, you may have select a small little thing here, and then you didn't realize you select it. And then you do anything you do, you like try all sorts of things, it doesn't work, right? Usually because you have this small little selection that you did not know you selected. So it's happening to this small area of the image, like maybe 1 pixel you do not know, then whatever you press, it doesn't work. Okay, and to unselect is always, you just select, deselect, and then take that selection away. Or I would recommend that over time, you all should remember all the keyboard shortcuts. Like this is Command D, so Command D, deselect it. Okay. So let's talk about filters. This is a very hot word right now, right? How many of you here use Instagram? Please tell me. Cannot be only one, lah. Right. Okay, so filters is a word that you see a lot in Instagram, right? But filters in Photoshop is not the same as Instagram filters. If you go to here, there's this word filters. If you go filter, you choose any of these, it does not make any of your picture look better. You can choose to noise, add noise, right? And nobody wants to do this to their picture, right? You go filter, you can go blur. And I want to blur my picture.
and then you go Gaussian blur, and I think blur my picture, like, why would I want to do this? Right, and you go filter, maybe render, and you go cloud, and the whole thing goes like this. So, Photoshop filters are actually very, very specialized. Okay, I'll show you very quickly one use of filters. Okay, I'm just, if you can follow me, you can open up this other image here, car, radar blur. Okay, so this is a picture of a car. And what we can do is that we can make the car look like it's moving by, you can zoom in on the wheel here. Select your elliptical marquee tool. Okay. Now notice I'm holding on to shift, and this allows me to make it to a perfect circle. But off, I'm going to press space bar now, and I'll be able to move it into the wheel. Okay, so I selected the wheel, and we want to make it spin, we go blur, radial blur, and we hit OK. And this will make it look like the car is moving. Right, you can do the same thing for like you go filter blur, you can do motion blur, and you see this makes like the car is actually moving forward a little bit more. Right, so that's roughly how you use filters. I can show you a bit more crazy filter stuff. Let's see, I don't think I have this file there for you. Okay, so this image is actually not this one. Okay, so probably I think Philip and Peter have seen me do this presentation before. This image is looks like it's a church and it's raining and there's lightning and everything, but in actual fact this was actually manipulated in Photoshop. So this is the original image, and we actually are able to... So one of the filters just now you saw that had clouds. This is the back of it. And then we added lightning to it, added a glow to it, and I'm going to show you how I actually make this rain. Okay, so we create a layer, and we can do see the movie. It's not very bright, not very clear. No wonder can you see this. Okay, so we basically fill it up with gray first, and we go to filter and we go to okay, so you go to noise and you add noise. And we put monochromatic noise, which is just adding this. Okay, and then we go to filter and we go to blur. Okay, and then when we actually do a motion blur on this. Okay, and then we put a change this to screen. Yeah, and that's actually how you get your rain. It's actually by making noise and actually making it motion blur to make it look like it's going one direction. So that's actually how you get
so-called fake rain. Okay. Anyway, that's one not really part of the scope of this. Just wanted to show you guys. Okay. So far do you guys follow or are you all lost or you don't know what's going on already? You still okay? Okay. Then I'll come to the most important feature of Photoshop, which is layers. Photoshop works basically on layers and everything works on layers. Layers is the thing that does everything in Photoshop. So if you saw this, coming back to this file, you see that everything here is actually one layer, one layer, one layer, one layer. And I think layers is quite easy. I think you guys understand the concept of layers, right? You understand that you actually have one layer on top of another layer on top of another layer. You can think of it like you have a lot of transparency and you put it together and that forms your image. So you might have a background image and then you put something on top, that's another layer, that's another layer, that's another layer. Okay, and for Photoshop, everything works on layers. So let's just do a new document. And the most important panel here is the layers panel. Okay, so the layers panel basically has can do a lot of things. Okay, so we're going to start here with just the background layer, and let's edit, fill this with foreground color. So the foreground color refers to this color here, and this white refers to the background color. Okay, so if I click OK, that fills it with color. Then now if I click on this, okay, so that creates a new layer. Then I have one more layer on top, and I can just randomly take a brush, and I can draw on top. Okay, put another layer, take another color, draw. And third color, green color, draw. Okay, so you can understand, it's quite easy to understand, right? What's happening here. We have layer 1, 2, 3 and the background layer. So the background is actually this gray color, one layer on top, one layer, and this layer. So if I were to drag this layer down, it actually changes the orientation, so the green now goes below the blue, and vice versa, I can put the red on top, stuff like that. So which one goes on top of the other? Right? One thing that you will need to know about layers is that, so you see this is, when we start a new, just now when you start a new Photoshop document, right, you realize it looks like that. Okay, so this is a white background, as opposed to this. Okay. Who knows what this means? Have you encountered this? Okay, so this here is a layer of white. Okay, what is this? What is this a layer of? Everybody knows? Okay, so this is a layer of nothing. Okay. To very simply illustrate this point, let's just go onto the bring Mickey Mouse in here.
Okay, so let's open up Mickey Mouse. Okay. So this is a regular JPEG file I just got off the internet. Okay. You click on the move tool, we can take this image and we can drag it into here. Okay. That looks fine. But what happens when we drag it into here? You see where the, so you see we have this area here that is white. Okay, now let's look for another image which I saw just now. So let's see, we go down here and what the Pikachu. Okay. So you see the same thing that happens here. Right. Okay, I'm gonna two things. I'm just going to save this image down. Okay. Anyway, I just copy and paste the image. And you see what the difference here is, that around here there's nothing. So if I were to move here, if I move it onto here, you cannot see the difference because on the white background. But now if I were to take my... Okay, sorry. So if I were now to activate back this layer, you see very the main difference here, right? The Mickey Mouse with the back, the white background is there, and this one does not have any background. So there's one thing very important in Photoshop, which is the transparency. Right, if the image is transparent like this, you will see it on the grey background. But most images, when we come up with the starting image like this, this is pure white. Right. What we want is actually some areas. It's very important that for images that they should be transparent if you want to bring it across to another background. You guys understand this part? Okay? If I'm losing you, please let me know.
You always have a background layer.
Sorry?
Background layer, you always have a background layer.
No, not necessary. You can, if let's say you don't want this background layer, you can always delete it off. And it's gone. So you don't have the background layer. When it starts, when you always put a new document, you always, you basically can choose either white background or transparent. You know, and then you'll create based on this. But what I'm trying to bring focus to you is that what is this checkered symbol in Photoshop, which is very important. That means that there's actually nothing there. Okay, so this happens on... So this is layers. Okay, so what else? Okay, so I'm just going to dive deeper into layers because layers is just one term, and there are a lot of things that happen in layers. The first one that happens in layers is layer mask. Have you heard of... So you know what's a mask? You ever heard of a mask? So I'm going to go back to my... Go back to this photo. Okay, so when we want to, I'm going to bring you into a term in Photoshop, which if you go to a lot of YouTube videos or a lot of tutorials, they're going to use this term, and it's called non-destructive editing. Okay,
the term suggest is non-destructive, means that you don't actually destroy anything. So let me show you what is destructive editing first. Destructive editing means that after you have done something to it, you cannot bring it back. So the most common thing is that I just take a brush and I just drag this over. Say, I've destroyed this layer. Because what happens is that this image now has a permanent green line over it, unless I undo. Right? Why we would say non-destructive is, let's say if I were to use a new layer like this, and now if I draw a green line over it, I'm not destroying the original image. Why? Because this green line is on top of the image. So this image, actually nothing happened to it. The green line is not there. The green line is on the layer on top. So this is what is important in Photoshop, that we try to edit our image non-destructively, so that if any time we realize that, oh, we did too much, we can actually just move back. Okay. So let me show you what we're going to do. So let's say we want to remove the sky here. Okay, but if we were to take this is the eraser tool. Like if we were to take eraser tool and then we eraser, we are doing destructive editing because it's gone. Right? So a layer mask is what helps you delete something but not actually delete something. It creates a mask over it. That means when you mask this area, right, it disappears, you don't see. Okay, so we're gonna do you click on this small little icon here at the bottom, add a mask. Okay. And what happens is that now you see here you have two windows. And remember, and notice that everything is still happening only on the layers panel. Okay, the layers panel is what most of everything happens. So you see now it's purely white. Okay. So it's very simple. If anything that you, so you can click here or click here. Okay, notice. So when you click here means that this, the layer, the image is selected. When you click here means the mask is selected. Okay, and anything you paint in black here goes away. So now if I click on a brush tool here, right, this is black color. Okay, I'm erasing. Okay, but now if I were to just click on here, which I switch it to become white, and with the brush I paint. Everything come back. Okay, so any part that is white will be seen, any part that is black is not seen. So that's why when you want to, let's say we want to, for example, remove the sky here, right, we could zoom in, and it works also with all the selection tools. So like just now I was using this quick selection tool, right, and I can just select the sky, something like that, okay. And now I select the layer mask, okay. I select it to black, I say edit, fill. Okay, it's going to fill the layer mask, and I'm going to fill it with foreground color and click OK. So it removed the sky for me, but it's actually not removing the sky, because if I were now to go back to white color here, and I were to put a brush and I brush, it's actually still there. So this is how you can delete something but not actually delete something. So usually, let's say you have an image of a person and you're trying to crop out the person, and you go very very close, right, then you will slowly edit, so you will use a layer mask and you might kill off, then you realize you kill off too much of the person, then you just switch back to white and you just paint back what you have deleted. Okay, and it doesn't mean that it has to be white and black. It will work anything between white and black. So if you were to choose gray now, what it will do is that it will delete 50% of it. If you take 50% gray, you delete 50% of it. So now if I were to, it is probably not that easy. Lighter gray.
Okay, so this one it's not this color, huh? It's actually deleting 50% of it. So if you actually zoom in, right, you can still see that there's part of it still there. So usually this, how we use this technique is that when we are very close to the edge of a person, right, we do not want straight away like one straight line, you know, you delete off everything here and everything here. Keep. From what you delete to what you have, this area here is actually a smooth blend of pixels that actually slowly disappearing. Okay, so this is layer mask and this is this part here. Now,
can be another layer or has to be the same layer?
Which one? The layer mask?
The mask.
The mask has to be on the same layer. The mask is tied to that layer, means I'm masking this layer. So it cannot be... Okay, it actually can be a... You can mask the whole group.
Can you create another layer?
That means if you put everything together in a... This might be a bit confusing, but if there's this thing called group, and if you put group and then you have like... a lot of different, you put a lot of components together, right? You can mask the whole group. This is actually a little bit, this might confuse you guys, but... okay, let me show you, let's say I were to take Mickey Mouse again and I put this in. Okay, so I have two layers now. Okay, and I put these two layers in this group, so I'm actually, it's grouped together. I can actually put a layer mask on the... Okay, put a layer mask on the group. And then when I actually mask it here, it will mask both together. So this is like, it's not actually masking here, but it's actually masking this whole group. I don't know if that's your question. Kind of blah. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Oh, you want to see the layer mask, is it? So that's why it's called non-destructive, because there's nothing has happened to the image.
Okay.
Yeah.
So for example, sir, can you pick another layer for layer 2? Pick another layer. Layer 2. 0, 1, and 2.
I think my Mac doesn't want to go away. Ideas thinking. Any ideas how to get my mic?
Is it because we can't know anything? Back or iPad?
No, this the taskbar is going to go away now.
Oh, oh, I was tricked. There, no idea.
It's supposed to open.
Okay. No, then you shift to left side. Position on screen for the left. Okay. Or right side. Okay.
So I click layer 2.
So can you use layer 2 as the masking layer?
No.
Okay.
You can't. Because the mask must tie to this... Yeah. Okay, so... okay, let's talk about adjusting photos. How many of you are actually interested in using Photoshop to adjust photos? I think you
adjust photo scene to use Lightroom, right?
Lightroom.
Use Lightroom, right? Okay, so. So, you have used, adjusting photos actually is quite similar. Okay, not very similar. So usually in let's say you use any iPhone app or anything, if you go to image, you will see something like brightness and contrast, right? That's probably what most people are going to hit for, go brightness and contrast, make it brighter. That's what you want to do. In Photoshop, there's actually a lot more control. So if you were to go and, if you were going to adjust your photos in Photoshop, okay, always use levels. Okay. And levels is actually very easy to use. There's only three sliders, or rather three rectangles here. This refers to the lightest part of the image, this refers to the darkest part of the image, and this is the middle part of the image. So if you have, you're going to make something brighter, like in this case, this photo is quite dark. We can shift, yeah, this will make it brighter. You see? Okay, and this will affect the lightest part, which in this case is obviously here, the sun and the sky and everything. But you can also shift the center slider, which will actually be this area, which is the mid-tones. Right? And this other slider is to make it darker the other way. Okay? This will make things darker. Okay, so usually what we'll do is that we will play, okay, maybe I want to do something like that. And then another very interesting adjustment is called hue and saturation, right? Hue and saturation basically, especially the saturation slider, it just makes the color pumps up like crazy. So like blue become more blue, green become more green in this case. And you can see that now suddenly like all the colors look very good. Right. Okay, but there's a problem. What we have done is called destructive editing again, right? Like now I found that actually now you see now the sun no longer there. That's bad. I don't want that. I want the sun there, you know. But you see that nothing I can do. Layer is one layer there. So I say, oh okay, I have to go and undo again. Okay. So the correct way to do image adjustment in Photoshop is again with layers, okay? And now we go to this second one, is called an adjustment layer. Okay, if you click on this, you'll see the same few adjustments that we have, and we can put on levels, right? And we can, so now it comes to here. Fortunately, it doesn't give you that big dialog, but it's over here under properties, and I can do the same adjustment. Here looks very nice, and you see what happens is that this is a layer, and if I can turn it on, turn it off, I realize that this adjustment was bad. I can just trash the whole adjustment. I did not destroy the whole image. But now you see on the right side, you see this familiar white square which I showed you just now, right? This is a mask. And in the same way, I can click on a brush here, black color, and I can paint back this sky that I want. Because the sky obviously is a lot nicer that way. So I have the sky which looks good and the front which looks, you know, the front here looks correct, but the sky, we killed too much of the sky by making it too bright. So this way I'm able to get back the sky. By using a layer mask, saying that I do an adjustment layer but I mask off this area which I do not want. And then you can add a second time again. just now I did hue and saturation, and I can put saturation this. Okay, and we realize that maybe we say that yeah, this part looks nice. This color of the blue on the water a little bit too blue, not natural. Okay, I can again choose a black color brush. Select this adjustment layer, and then I can just paint a really blue color that I don't want. Or maybe you say that, oh, actually the blue looks okay, but not so blue. So we don't have to use black. We can use gray. And paint again, become a little bit blue. I don't know whether you can see that. Okay, so not that blue, not that. Looks a little bit more blue, and but still not that blue. So same thing, layers. Very important in Photoshop. Works here and works in... it's not only just composing new images, it can be an adjustment layer. So you can add more and more and more and more stuff, you know, and... Yeah, the most common, actually another very... effect that you see very often is... Okay, so let's say I take a picture of a girl, right? I can go filter and I can say black and white. And then I put everything down to black and white, it's not there. But I can say I just go to her eyes, right, and I just I did, and that's another effect. So nothing. So sometimes they have like a wedding photo where you know the holding the rose is red and the whole image is black and white. Yeah, that's how you can very quickly achieve the effect. Right. So everything into layers. Okay. While we are here, I can just show you actually what this this demonstration I did. Okay, so what we have here with the girls is that let's say you wanted to do a beauty makeup, okay, very quickly, is that I can go to here and say convert to smart object. Okay, smart object is a very lengthy subject, so I'm not going to go into the whole thing, but what I wanted to show you is that if I were to convert into a smart object and I go now to filter, blur, Gaussian blur, okay, the Gaussian blur actually basically blurs the image, so if I put a lot less, but what we can do is we can put until somewhere. You see here, I have a layer mask as well. And what I can do is I can slowly bring back a feature. So we take the most important parts, it's like the berry. Okay, and then we bring it down. And what you can do is basically with this technique is that you slowly you make the person's face a little bit more smooth. I can't remember the exact parameter that I used for this. Okay, so you can also use that with layer mask. That means you maybe blur the whole thing and only a certain thing you focus.
Sorry.
Okay, you're using the history brush. That's what you use the history brush. If you click here, it should be the brush. What you have is... there is such a thing as a history brush, I know. But you should be using the brush to, if, to be quick, you can just press the B button. The history brush on. Yours looks something like this. So you should be a brush, don't have this small little arrow there. Okay? Let me just show you a few more other stuff. Okay, so adjusting photos, adjustment layers, and okay. So roughly, that is what I, more or less what I can cover with you guys on Photoshop. The basic is that the most important two things is selections and layers. Okay, these two are the most important concepts you must learn in Photoshop. Okay, I'll show you some of the more common, some other features that, or rather some of the actions that's very commonly done in Photoshop. Okay, so object removal. Let's say you have something in the image that you do not want it. Like for example, this. Okay, let's start with something simple. Let's say you have this boat here, right? We don't want the boat. Okay, I'm getting rid of the boat. So, what you do is that this is the most, one of the most famous tools in Photoshop called clone stamp tool. Okay, you basically clone from somewhere and then you bump on top. Okay, and so you select it, and what you do is that same thing, you hold up alternate, you'll become this icon, and then you select an area of it, and then you go over here, and then you can just clone. Okay, get rid of it. So it's a very common, one of the most common tools around. Okay, so this is, and what I've done here is again destructive editing, which is not good. So what you should do by right is you should create a new layer and then do this on a new layer, because then if you ever need the boat back, it's actually just one layer on top. So this is actually just a patch that you put on top. Can do the same thing for, okay, so for this guy it's a little bit more complex, right? You can do it, right, but what you have to do is you have to slowly go section by section here. Make the rocks go back first, rocks cover up with legs, then you go over here and you go. And like this, and you kind of like remove him. Right? So this is how it's always been done. Let me show you something that... so in recent years, right, Adobe has... this was actually when it was like still CS4, CS5, you had to do this. And in recent years, Adobe had this technology called Content Aware. Okay, which is... when it works, it's very amazing. When it doesn't work, it's just totally crap. So what you do is you can just select with your magic, I'm using lasso tool here, you select the area you want, and if you click edit, I'm sure you can do this with a new layer. Okay, you go edit fill, and the content, I can say content aware. Because I need to select on that. Yeah. Okay, the bad part is that it has to do it on the actual image itself, so you are going to do destructive editing. So edit fill, edit, okay. And it does the work for you. Okay. Yeah, you can do it here. Okay, feel. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. Let me just try another image. Let's try this image here. So we have this group of people. I'm not sure. I actually have not tried this. Okay, so we go edit, fill, content aware. Ta-da!
Wow.
So when it works, it's really good. Okay,
back
from FOC,
the difference.
Because there's
a stone there.
Yeah, so it based on the image around here, and then it just...
put the stone there.
Oh. So in fact, actually, if you do like 20 pixel feather, it'll probably look better. Okay, so it is in quite a lot of different tools. Like they use this other tool called the spot healing brush. Okay, and you can also choose content aware here. Okay, so there's also edit content aware scale, but this is the most. Is the most pian xiao one. It only works for a very, very specific kind of image. I'll show you a. Can I do it? Let's see what happens if I do that. It doesn't work with this image. Okay, but yeah. So that's new technologies from Adobe. If you go on to most of YouTube channel, they are probably going to show you Pro-Stamp 2, which is the most common way that people remove something. But content aware on the especially on the healing brush can be very powerful. It's like, let's say you scan something, right? There's a lot of noise or something. You can actually just sometimes you just use a spot healing brush. You just take or you scan and then there's a hair there, right? Then you can actually just use the spot healing brush, you just brush over the hair and the hair can disappear. Okay, videos. So now Photoshop also miraculously can do videos. Okay, so everything, so you just, like this is an MP4 file, this is a video. I can open it with Photoshop. Okay, I can, I can scrub through, okay, work as how you work with most video software. But what is cool is that everything that I told you about just now applies to a video as well through the layers. So okay, so let's go back to the all powerful video channel. And if I wanted to, I can add a layer mask and go to brush and remove part of this video and I will still be able to play it. Okay, which means that if I wanted, I could actually get Mickey Mouse again. I drag him into this video file. Okay, it will be at his own layer here. I drag him behind. Where is he actually? So I have Mickey there. And I can actually zoom in with here. And if I actually play this video, you'll see Mickey Mouse will stay on the background. Okay. Right, because I have actually... So the movement is because this guy has actually moved to animation.
Can
you
get Photoshop and do video?
Yeah, you can do video. Yeah, and so you can do that, you can do all the other stuff, like for example we talk about adjustment layers. You can click and put an adjustment layers like black and white, right? And that will give you a black and white layer. You can, after that, you can go onto the layer mask and a certain portion, that portion will become color. For some reason you might want to do that, and then you can actually also just play the video. So all the tools that you are familiar with in Photoshop, like what I showed you just now, layer mask, everything, can be done on video as well.
For example, you have a stone in the middle of the population.
No, you can't do that. That is quite called frame by frame editing. So you have to do it one by one, yes, you can.
Yeah, like this, it doesn't...
No. Yeah, that's why it's not really a video editing software. It does video for certain stuff if you want.
Or battling, all these are okay.
Yeah, I can do quite a few things, like for example it can do also like opacity, and then it's like up here and it slowly fades away. You can do stuff like that. A little bit here and there lah, so once it hits to here, and then it slowly just fades away and gone. You can add text and whatever you want on top of it. If, let's say you're doing like a simple 5-second video, you can use this to do stuff. I personally use it a little bit. So you can do that as well. Yeah, and that's about all I have for you guys. We have about 15 minutes remaining. Do you have any specific questions you have on Photoshop? I can try to answer them. Like, you have seen something done, you're not sure how it's done. If I can answer that, I'll answer that.
What is the price to pay for Photoshop?
Sorry?
The price of the software.
Price of the software. So Adobe now works with this, unfortunately everything is on cloud. And go to Photoshop. Yeah, what you can do is it's quite interesting. So the photography package, this is Lightroom plus Photoshop together, and it's $13 a month, but paid monthly. Lightroom and Photoshop together. So it's a photography package. This is a single app, so it is Photoshop only, and $312. Yeah, it's weird. So apparently they give you the Behance and cloud storage. Apparently they feel that you should pay an extra $150 a year. No idea why.
For occasional user?
No, the problem is that now it's very expensive. So I would say that if you want, you can just buy the photography package on the process. Yeah. It's cheaper when you buy a whole year. Monthly is more expensive. This one is all apps. That's the Creative Cloud. That's a Creative Cloud. I mean, everything that you get now. It's very... Because last time you used to be able to buy like individual apps and you could buy like a design package only. But now it's... They don't give you a lot of options.
No, it's one time purchase.
So after 1 year, you have to pay another 156.
You used to pay, you pay one time.
Yeah, last time it used to be box edition, now there's no such thing.
No more.
Yeah, for quite some time already. So, unfortunately, they have a very strong monopoly of the graphic arts market, so yeah.
The moment you stop paying, it's totally a bad fail. Will not work already.
Because you every time you go in you must no it will every don't know how many weeks you'll keep pinging the Adobe server.
Oh.
Then if you never pay then you will just cut off. Yes, they are a very rich company and they do not support user groups anymore. We used to be the Adobe user group in Singapore. Creative Crew used to be the official user group for Adobe. And back when you're CS4, we actually had support from Adobe and everything, and then over the years they decide that no, there's no more. Last time used to have a country manager some more. Then after that, for country manager, you don't see the country manager, you see the uni online presence. Then after that, totally there's no such thing as Adobe user group anymore.
You have a student plan.
Yes. You can take the student plan. School and university. Yeah. So this one is at $26 a month, it's for all apps. So it's very worthwhile. So it's like just now Photoshop alone, $312. For student a month, everything is $312. Yeah. School day. Anyone else has any other questions? You are trying anything, cannot get it done, just let me know, I can go over and help you guys. But, okay, so in summary, learn all this stuff first. Once you have comfortable with this stuff, then you will start to look at all the other. Because there's way too much in Photoshop to actually master everything. And after you have understand the tools, then you understand the technique of using the tools. Then you can start to do more. Yeah. Okay. Anyone have any other questions? Oh. If you guys have any questions, just post on the Creative Crew user group and we will try to answer them. Or you can post inside this event as well. Okay. Well, thank you very much.